the very first thing I should say is our president's very sorry that she's unable to be here tonight. As you've probably seen in the media, we have a problem with junior doctors at the moment, and she's been very much engaged all day with the Department of Health trying to sort something out. But let me welcome you all. It's a real privilege to have the Royal Photographic Society here tonight, and particularly for the college to be engaged in the Royal Photographic Society Joint Medical Royal College's award of this honour to Professor Fercher. And we're delighted to have you here this evening, Professor Fercher, as well. Just to tell you very briefly, the Royal College of Physicians was established in 1518 by a royal charter of Henry VIII, and so we've been here now for almost 500 years trying to promote better healthcare and raise clinical standards for our patients. This building is, as you probably all know, a Grade 1 listed LASDEN building, and it's a wonderful place to have our headquarters. And this is actually our fifth home, but it's a particular pleasure for us to welcome other Royal Societies to join us, and we're delighted to be able to work with you on this award for the photographic medal. So I'd just like to say thank you all very much for coming here, and we look forward very much to continue working with you. Thank you.
I would now like to introduce our brand new, newly elected president. But before I do that, I had a telephone conversation with the president last week, and I jokingly said, "It will only take me 25 minutes to introduce you." And he said, "Why are you rushing it?" Right, as I said, he's the newly elected president of the Royal Photographic Society, who, having served on the council, and then he was elected as the society treasurer, and then he was elected the vice president, and eventually he was duly elected, unopposed, as the president of the Royal Photographic Society this September. He has just returned from South Africa, and the evidence of his having been to South Africa, on close observation, you will notice he's got a tan. Now, his tan is not as good as mine. He got it from South Africa, mine is from sunny Rochdale. Not only that, his is temporary, mine is permanent. Right. Now, one of the things which happens practically to all the presidents, they get invited to China and many other countries. And of course, the president will be willing to travel to many countries. And now that Sierra Leone has eradicated Ebola, you might consider that country as well. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Walter Benzie, Honorary FRPS, to introduce the speaker of this evening, Walter.
Good evening, everybody. One of the, I've actually been taken, I've lost for words here, because I normally feel that the Royal Photographic Society heritage is very strong and very old, but we've only been going for 160 odd years or so, and actually to be out-trumped so massively by professor beforehand of 500 years of this establishment does put us in our place. One of the joys of the Royal Photographic Society is our mandate, which is to promote the art and science of photography. Some of our founding members were astronomers, chemists, and physicists. Actually, just as a little side issue, my favorite subject at school was physics, and so I've always been interested in the scientific side of our organization. It does seem, though, that more frequently I'm getting involved in the artistic side, in the artistic interpretations, but science is at the very roots of our organization, and long may it be so. Professor Fercher is indeed a very serious scientist, and he was awarded the Combined Colleges Medal in 2014, and recipients of this award are punished by having to give a lecture here, but actually this will be a lecture, I think, of considerable interest to a quite wide range of people. I read that Professor Fercher was collaborating with the Zeiss company, a name known to all of us as synonymous with top-class optics. Interestingly, and to me, and incidentally, glass is actually a very fundamental part of a lot of our work. In fact, I learnt at a recent lecture that, in fact, the 1851 exhibition in London, which had all sorts of glass buildings built up around, that glass technique enabled the plates for the photographic glass plates to be actually made. That was flat, level, and of the right size and dimensions. Zeiss, of course, collaborated with Herr Schott of a very famous sort of glass family. And in fact, they were looking at ways for many years of improving the quality of the optics and the materials. It's perhaps appropriate that Professor Fercher has actually concentrated his skills on examining the human eye, our own built-in lens on life, if you would prefer it that way. I'm also told that the techniques that he has been using and he will discuss tonight are non-invasive. So that should be there should be no issues with anyone here who might have a slightly squeamish nature. However, I have to say as a little aside, the recipient of our 2015 award, his special subject is the examination of the gastro tract, particularly from throat to anus, using a miniature camera that is recovered and after swallowing through natural causes. I can only hope that there is a very thorough cleaning technique used before it is used for the next patient. Therefore, I can only say to you, it's with huge relief and great relief that I hand over to Professor Fercher. Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you very much for your kind words. And I have to thank the Royal Photographic Society, Mr. President, of course. I have also to thank Roy Robertson as the chair of the awards committee. And finally, I would like to thank Mrs. Jo McDonald, helping me overcome some administrative problems, many administrative problems. Most of the problems I have created, the solutions came from you, thank you. So I am talking about coherence tomography. Principles, basic properties, recent, only some aspects, it's a huge field, yes. I will concentrate on some aspects of that problem or of that science. So, and I have three sections in my talk. I will start with, now let me say more or less the old coherence-based OCT, time domain OCT. My central talk will be concentrated on Fourier domain OCT or spectrum-based OCT. And finally, I will present some examples, not from ophthalmology. I will have several examples during the first two sections on out from the field of ophthalmology. But the second or the third part will concentrate on some investigations, for example, in cardiology and other fields, depending on the time I have. Okay. Now, the first section, as I mentioned, will be on time domain OCT. This is a huge field. It's more or less the last 20 years were nearly concentrated on time domain OCT. I will only concentrate on basic steps and basic properties. These items here are too huge. I have to cancel these items. I have canceled these. But anyway, I will come back to the problem of light sources in the Fourier domain section and interferometers as well. Okay. So, before OCT already, there has been, since the invention of lasers, some fields in the medical science that used lasers. For example, laser Doppler,
laser Doppler technology, speckle technology, laser vision test, maybe some other smaller fields as well. Now, my personal situation changed in 1975. Since 1975, I spent 7 years with the Carl Zeiss company, where I was engaged in the holographic measurement of lightweight satellite mirrors and checking or... Thank you. Developing techniques for with computer-generated holograms for production control. Then in 1975, I got an appointment at the University of Essen, where I was concentrating on the education of physics and medical students, and did some research in pattern recognition. And because I had to educate medical students or medicine students as well, I had a lot of contact with the clinic there, and I asked them, what can I do for you? Well, one of the answers was, yes, there's a problem with eye length measurement. Ultrasound is not perfect. That was one of the questions, but there were many other questions. I thought that, okay. So, yes, I start with my lecture now, or with my program. I beg your pardon, the first slide will be rather selfish. It's again my past. And later on, it's only the first slide, yes. So in 1982, we detected this interference phenomenon that you can possibly see here. Up to that time, it was not clear if we can really obtain regular interferences. Of course, it was clear that one can have a speckle field if one illuminates, for example, the eye. So it was my laboratory worker who convinced me, after I told him, we should see interferences, regular interferences, if we illuminate the eye with a laser beam. But it took me 3 hours on an afternoon and without result. And then this laboratory worker, he was more convinced from my idea than he himself. He told me, no, you are not going home, Mr. Professor, we are continuing. And in fact, we found these interferences. After then, it was very easy to see these interferences if we know there are interferences. Okay, that was the first step. The next step was that we used these interferences using low coherence light for length measurement. And one of the results of this length measurement, of course, was then the eye length measurement, I will get familiar with that equipment during this speak. So in cataract or in determining the focal length of intraocular lenses for cataract surgery. And one of the first results is shown here. We could demonstrate that if cataract surgery is being performed and an intraocular lens then is implanted, you can use either ultrasound technique to determine the focal length of the intraocular lens, or you could, as a first time, use the optical technique. And the result was convincing. If these surgeons would have used the optical data for the intraocular lens, then we would have a result where no ametropia larger than 1 diopter would have occurred. But they used the ultrasound technique data to determine the focal length of the eye lens, so they had ametropia up to 2.5 diopters. So then this situation was clear. So we could concentrate on the next step. The next step, the next step then was, of course, to include the next dimension, the transverse dimension. And a first step is shown here. In the meantime, in the meantime, of course, there were many other people who noticed that with low coherence light one can do anything in ophthalmology, and a very powerful group in the United States, Professor Fujimoto and his team at the MIT, they were quicker than we. At least they published the first in vitro OCT, but we were the first publishing an in vivo OCT. So that's the situation we had there. If you ask me, the only flaw here is blue. All what is black is okay for me. Blue is not okay. But that is the reality. That means, of course, the MIT team in this point was quicker than we, at least as far as in vitro OCT is concerned. Now, what am I talking about? What am I talking about this? I'm talking about time domain OCT here. That will be the basis for the next remarks I make. The basis of that technique is the Michelson interferometer. The Michelson interferometer has a beam splitter, it has a light source, it has a reference mirror, and it has a sample beam. So, what is an OCT image? It contains an A scan that is performed using the reference mirror that gives here an output signal along such a line, for example. And in addition, to get a two-dimensional image, we need a so-called transverse or lateral scanning can be performed with that mirror here across the fundus of the eye, for example. So that is the technique to generate optical coherence tomograms. We have a lateral OCT scan and we have a depth scan. The depth scan usually is termed as A scan. I will use that word several times in this talk, and we have a lateral OCT scan. Okay. Now, we all know that OCT has a long history or a severe history in ophthalmology. And the first and maybe the most important motivation to use laser interferometry in ophthalmology can be seen here. If you have to determine the structure of the fundus, for example, here in the background of the eye, with a focused laser beam, a Gaussian beam from a laser, for example, that is geometric optics, although Gaussian beam is more or less a wave optics beam, then we have a standard numerical aperture of the eye of 0.04 that gives a transversal resolution here of about 30 micrometers. But if you try to measure the length of the eye here or the depth of the fundus, you can do that only using the Rayleigh criterion, and then the result is 320 micrometers. And that is a disaster. That is the reason why ultrasonic techniques have been used to measure the length of the eye. They were at least a factor of 3 or 4 better than the optical technique. But the low coherence technique provided us with a precision of 20 micrometers. That is about the precision of the IOL master that is now used in eye length measurement. Okay. This is the motivation. Then, with the motivation many years ago, about 1980 or 85, I have now the next step. I will show you the highlights of OCT, that is why OCT is so successful. The first point, of course, is as OCT uses low coherence depth measurement. The first highlight is that we use an interferometric technique and that yields more or less interferometric resolution. We will still have 2 other highlights. Maybe some of you are familiar with the interference law. This is the interference term. Those who are not familiar with that can forget it. I hope you can understand the picture here. That explains what is interferometric resolution in our case. We have to use low coherence interferometry. That is, we cannot use a helium nane laser, for example, for length measurement, because the result would not be unique. But if we use low coherence light, then we have limited wavelets, and an interferogram at the exit of the interferometer only if the pass difference between reference beam and sample beam is equal within the length of these wavelets. And the length of these wavelets is the so-called coherence length, and that gives the precision of this measurement technique. So this is the highlight number one, the high interferometric resolution given by the coherence length of the light source. There are 3 examples. We have a broadband superluminescent diode here with a coherence length of about 6 micrometers. This is a Kerlens modulated titanium sapphire laser, yields a coherence length of 2 micrometers or even less. And finally, we have a halogen lamp. There are some OCT techniques that really also use these halogen lamps as light source with a coherence length of 1 micrometer. But the application of this type of light sources in OCT, in the field of OCT, is rather limited. Okay. So then what are the optical parameters if we want some depth resolution? We have here the bandwidth of the light. The larger the bandwidth is, the smaller is the coherence length. And we have here the axial resolution. So if we want to have high axial resolution, that means here a small number, of course, yes, 1 micrometer, for example, and use light of 800 nanometers, then we need a bandwidth of 300 nanometers. That is not easy to obtain. So, and we have no chance, for example, with these large wavelengths. Okay, so if we want to have high axial resolution, we need large bandwidths, and even it is recommended to use a short wavelength. So, the highlight number one is the depth and transverse resolution are separated. Of course, what I have just explained is that depth resolution is given by the coherence length, whereas transverse resolution, of course, is given by the numerical aperture of the optics focusing the sample beam or the probing beam. So transverse resolution is given by the numerical aperture and depth resolution by the wavelength. This is not the case in classical imaging. Furthermore, this is not a highlight, this is a problem. transverse resolution depends on the numerical aperture, and that means that transverse resolution affects more or less against the depth of field. So low transverse resolution gives us a large depth of field, high transverse resolution gives us a low depth of field. This is a problem we encounter when using OCT techniques. And the last highlight I want to mention is the outstanding sensitivity of interferometry. That is again a result of using an interferometric technique. For example, if we want to see the cornea, it is sufficient to have a sensitivity of 20 dB, that means two orders of magnitude. That means light reflected from the cornea is about 1% of the light intensity we use to illuminate the cornea. That changes definitely if we go to the anterior chamber. If we want to see light from the anterior, from the back surface of the eye lens, for example, we have an attenuation of 50 dB, that is five orders of magnitude. And finally, if we want to see the fundus, we have seven orders of magnitude loss of or reduced light coming back from the fundus. So this is not a very nice situation, but OCT does help in this case, namely because it is an interferometric technique. So here are two examples that show the principle. If we have, so the thin error means a low intensity beam, and the thicker error is a higher intensity beam. If we superimpose the two, maybe you understand that the result is more or less the intensity of the high intensity beam. But this is the case of incoherent light. If we use coherent light, that is the interferometric technique, we get a modulation, and that is a very distinct signal. That means in numbers, if we have sample light, and now I'm talking about OCT, we have a sample with an intensity of 1, the amplitude then is the square root of 1 is also 1, and we use a reference signal with intensity 100, then the square root, the amplitude is 10, and this result of the 2 is the maximum of the interferogram, that is 11, and the minimum is the difference of the 2, that is 9, so we have 11 squared gives an intensity of, this is the incoherent sum, yes, if the 2 are added, that is 1 plus 100 is 101, there's no difference, like that. But the 12 squared gives a maximum intensity of 122, and the minimum 980 is 81, so we have a large modulation here. This is a very important basic, a very important feature of OCT. Then this can be put in numerical figures. I am not going into the details here. I simply explain the diagram here. We have here reflectivity of the reference beam, and here the sensitivity that can be achieved. So it's about 100 dB. If you remember the 70 dB we have at the fundus, then the 100 dB is more than sufficient to see the fundus of the eye. So we have, okay. If we compare that with the incoherent situation, then we see we have a sensitivity of only about 70 dB in case of incoherent light. That is what I just explained in very simple words just before. That means from the fundus we get more or less no incoherent signal. Okay. So, then there is a further possibilities to increase the sensitivity using dual balance technique gives plus 5 dB, and using the Fourier technique gives an additional 20, even 30 dB sensitivity. So this is really a very important feature of OCT, sensitivity. So this was what is the same for all the OCT techniques. Also for time domain OCT as well as for Fourier domain OCT. And this ends my first chapter, and I will point to some properties of tuning light sources, which are the optimal light sources for Fourier domain OCT. And finally, I will point to one or two advanced interferometric techniques in this field. So, what is Fourier domain OCT? There are two approaches. There is a pragmatic approach, or a formal approach, or let me say a mathematical approach. One can simply replace the interference law as we had just used it in time domain OCT by the spectral function, that should say spectral power densities. This is the interference law in spectral terms. So, and the Wiener-Kinchin theorem combines the spectral interference law with the time domain interference law. This is a formal approach. I don't like that approach, also because it does not give too much insight into the physics with which we are concerned here. A much better approach to that problem is the inverse scattering or technique or diffraction tomography. This technique has more or less introduced already 34 years ago by Emil Wolf. Nobody of you might know Emil Wolf. Klaus Fuchs a person known here? Atomic spy in England? Oh, yes. I think he was in Edinburgh, assistant professor or something like that. He has been, I think he has been catched and, sorry? Yeah, Max Born. Max Born had another nice guy, and that is Emil Wolf. And after Klaus Fuchs has been, I think he was killed, Emil Wolf was the follower of Klaus Fuchs in Edinburgh. So in England they said, oh, now is the Fuchs gone and the wolf is coming back. Oh, that is dangerous, even more dangerous. So I know Emil Wolf quite good since many years. He's retired now. He from Edinburgh, he then went to the United States. And he provided us with a very elegant solution of the scattering problem. And that, I would say, is the best basis for diffraction tomography. In Optics Communications 1969, he published a paper where he addressed that problem. The problem is, we have a scattering sample here, anything, yeah? Could be an eye, a fingernail, or whatever. And if we illuminate that, we can observe the scattered light in front or behind the scattering object or in front of the scattering. That is then backscattering and that is forward scattering. And for both cases, he provided a solution using the Born approximation, solving the Helmholtz equation. And this result is then simply that measuring the light behind or in front of the scattering object is given by the Fourier transform. This is the Green's function. This finally then ends in the Fourier transform of the so-called scattering potential. The scattering potential is, to a first approximation, simply the distribution of the refractive index. To be precise, it is the square of the refractive index minus 1 and multiplied with a constant. So, that is here in letters what I just said. Now, this is how to implement Wolf's technique. We have a sample here, we illuminate the sample, we have a reference mirror here, we have a reference beam, and then we detect the scattered light. We have to measure amplitude and phase of the scattered light, and then we have Fourier domain tomography. You might not recognize it if you're familiar with OCT, but we shall immediately see that this, in fact, the basis of Fourier domain OCT. I term that as Wolf's general solution because many years ago, we tried to use that solution. You see, that was in the 1970 and 1980, at about 1980. We tried to use that solution to replace lenses in optics. Of course, we don't need lenses. And in these years, 1980, and I'm an old man, yes, 1980 and so, we believed that, okay, there can be some X-ray laser in the next future or something like that, and then we do not have lenses. I was at that time still at University of Essen, yeah. And then we would have a perfect imaging system, simply measuring the scattered field, taking the Fourier transform, and the picture is there. Unfortunately, that was not so easy to perform that. Yes, of course. What is shown here is array detection. One could also use a flying spot or a synthetic aperture. I will address these alternatives during the next week, minutes. So that means I try to use, you see here, we have two solutions of Wolf. The original Wolf's solution, they can the Fourier transform X. In fact, there are some additional steps. We can also simplify this Wolf's solution to micro diffraction tomography. Wolf coined the expression diffraction tomography, yeah? Or sometimes it is also called holographic OCT, holographic because amplitude and phase are measured. But the basis is the Fourier transform. And the situation is extremely simple if we have microscopic subjects or microscopic samples, and that is what we tried to implement or to realize in 1979 with that experiment shown here. We used microscopic samples, Cephalic sphere, that is a type of sugar, of 40 micrometer diameter, and simply wanted to reconstruct that structure in a interferometric arrangement, yes? We have here the sample beam and we have here the reference beam. It's the same as in OCT. Unfortunately, the result was not very convincing. You see the result here. The experimental result was, I would not say a disaster, but we learned something. At that time, the technical possibilities were rather rough or pure or simple. So we could not use a photodetector array, for example, here. We had to use a photographic plate. We had to scan the photographic plate and so on. And so therefore is the result very, very pure. Also, or a little better, was the mathematical simulation. We used Mie theory to determine the scattered field of that sample and then Fourier transform to reconstruct the situation. That worked, more or less. But altogether, it was not a rather promising technique at that time. And why did we not more invest in that project? Because at that time, for example, computer processor speed, younger people might not believe that, but it is a fact, was six orders of magnitude less than a typical PC like that today, yes. And the computer was so large that it could have filled this room here, yes. That was on the University of Erlangen. Okay. So, but times have changed, and we have a first publication that is really using Wolf's theory. The paper has been published by, it's more or less the same configuration like that here, as you see, yeah. We have a sample, we have a laser, illuminate the sample, we have a reference, and we have a CMOS camera, and not a photographic plate here, of course. Also, they have provided that the reference point or the curvature of the reference beam is approximately equal to the average curvature of the sample beam. And the result was quite good, at least in their own words. They say, in vivo imaging of human disc is demonstrated with an image quality comparable to conventionally scanned OCT. Well, that's perfect. We fully reconstruct the object field with depth invariant image quality. So that means the old, I'd say old, it's new. Wolf's theory works. And I'm really convinced that this is the basis of Fourier domain OCT, Wolf's theory. I shall explain that now here. Here we have the original Wolf's geometry. Yeah? We have a sample. I have not depicted the reference mirror here in order to keep the image simple. And we have a detector array. So, and you might be convenient, or you might be familiar with the Fourier projection slide theorem. And if we that use, then we, instead of this three-dimensional reconstruction, we can also obtain the line detection diffraction tomography, or line detection Fourier domain OCT. Simply by using, for example, such a linear detector. That means what we measure then is the projection in the sample normal to the direction of the detector. Of course, we have to use a slim illuminating beam in the sample to get a reasonable image. If we use a point like detector or a point detector, then of course we get a complete projection of the scattering potential over X and Y direction. That means we have to use a focused beam if we would have want to obtain a reasonable result. And this is more or less the standard flying spot Fourier domain OCT, yes? We scan the sample with a focused laser beam and perform a Fourier transform. That means before that we determine the spectrum with a spectrometer, for example, and the Fourier transform gives us then the depth position of the sample at this point. Okay. So, therefore, I ask you a question, or I ask you to make your mind, is it now OCT or is it diffraction imaging? I feel it's diffraction imaging. There's an example for the slice, using the slice theorem. We obtained but the pictures are not really not satisfying. But we were quick, so we could within a millisecond obtain a tomogram with yeah, 250 × 512 pixels. But in the next step, the situation became quite better. More or less the same people. In the meantime, I was retired. They used the experience we had made in the project before, and then they got much better results. For example, using again the Fourier projection theorem, that means line field detection in the scattered field and Fourier domain technique. And here I think the picture is convincing as such. I need not to explain too much. We have here the fovea centralis. This is the papilla. Here is the optical, the lamina cribrosa of the optical nerve head. Okay. And in this case, a full stack of 500 pixels, 500,000 pixels, nearly half a million pixels, or half a million pixels, was recorded within half a second approximately. And that was already quite good. So we have, in fact, a first megahertz line field spectral Fourier domain OCT here. The early Fourier domain techniques used the flying spot or point detection technique. But as I explained just before, it is also based more or less on Emil Wolf's solution. We were not the first again. We were behind the MIT, but we could be the first who measured an A-scan signal using this technology, and the first Fourier domain image has been generated or performed by Chin, a co-worker of James Fujimoto from the MIT. Okay, I'm not going to explain. Also, a group around Gerd Häusler at Erlangen University, they were very quick to perform Fourier domain spectral OCT. I have published in 1995 a paper where I pointed to the fact at least that no moving parts are needed. That is one of the advantages of the Fourier domain technique. Another important technique is the far higher sensitivity. Okay. So, but there are two approaches possible in Fourier domain OCT. There's one approach that uses a spectrometer to get the spectral display of the scattered light. And there is another technology that uses swept frequency lasers to obtain the same result. Well, in this case, we have to use the spectrometer, as I mentioned, and in this case, we have a tunable laser and a photodetector. So, both techniques have been exploited by several groups. And at the moment, and we will see some examples, it seems that this swept source laser or swept frequency laser technology has an advantage. So I have collected some of the properties now of this Fourier domain-based interferometric imaging technique. First of all, we need no moving parts. There is no moving part here. We need not to translate a mirror and so on. Common to all these techniques is that depth resolution is given by the coherence length. The Fourier domain technique has a so-called Hermitian problem. That means straightforward measurement of the scattered light does not give amplitude and phase, but an intensity. So that is a problem, but there are many solutions. There's a lot of papers, and the problem is solved to obtain from an intensity scattered light amplitude and phase. Spectral absorption reduces sensitivity and resolution. That is clear. Why does Fourier domain technique have such a high sensitivity, 20 or 30 dB higher than time domain OCT? That can simply answer that question. Maybe some of you know Felgert's multiplex advantage. The point is simply that with the Fourier domain OCT, we do not have to measure depth by depth, but the whole signal at once. And that gives an advantage of, while Coma and co-workers have generated that diagram, which shows that depending on the source half width and the scan depth, sensitivity gain can be as large as 30 dB. So the mean value is about 20 dB more than time domain OCT. There are some other features here. I do not now discuss all these points. One disadvantage of Fourier domain technique is we cannot use confocal gating. That is, the time domain technique can focus to a certain depth, and that the detector have a light stop to filter out the scattered light that is scattered aside the main direction. This is one of the disadvantages. Okay. Now, of course, there were quickly, more or less soon, first publications with using this technology in Vienna, for example, we had the first clinical applications of Fourier domain OCT using the spectrometer technique. I'm not discussing all these pictures here. I'm coming to a question which is not very convenient for me. I have often been asked, why did you in Vienna so late use Fourier domain OCT, when on the other hand you have already published in 1995 that you don't need moving parts in this technology? And the problem is the following. Or the answer is the following, sorry. We did not have people to do that. Simply answer, yeah? But we could help us. And that help came from Poland. And from a European program. That was a structural joint program for Poland before Poland joined the EU. The European Union, there was a problem to reinforce and improve the academic education in Poland. And within that program, we were one of three universities that helped the universities in Toruń and Bydgoszcz to introduce a new study curriculum for the students in medical physics. Because before that, for example in Toruń, each year we were told about 50 physics students finished their studies well educated in radio astronomy. 50 people each year, so that was really more or less a nonsense. Okay. But that was a great help for us, because these two students, one is now an associate professor at Toruń. He has an OCT research group. He is very well known. And also Robert Zawadzki, he is assistant professor at the university that California Davis. So sometimes we had luck. Also, yes, maybe this is a little on the margin, an expert's opinion from 1999, that is Brett Boomer, out of the team of James Fujimoto, who had no doubt that even the endoscopic OCT technique could only be used combined with Fourier domain, with the high sensitivity of Fourier domain OCT. Okay, so question is, what is then next? Next, we have also already seen is three-dimensional OCT. We have already seen four-dimensional OCT, three space coordinates plus time. There are techniques or technologies that have implemented real-time OCT, that means immediately to see the result, and so on. What question is, what is next? Maybe new wavelengths or what? Okay. These are beautiful pictures from different diseases in the fundus of the eye, generated by Maciej Wojtkowski. And, okay. Now I come to a rather severe subject, and I think I will simplify that. The problem is the following. The question is, what do we see if we use OCT? Do we see the reality, or whatever do we see? And the answer is, I'm not going to all this procedure here. I am quickly moving to the next slide. The answer is the following. I do not explain now the complete system, but the idea is the following. We illuminate a sample. The sample is here. A sample in mathematical Fourier terms is consisting, it has different reflectivities in the volume of the sample. And this reflectivity structure can be understood in terms of Fourier analysis. That means as a superposition of harmonic Bragg gratings. And each such Bragg grating has a reflected wave. So if we illuminate in this direction, then the reflected wave might go in this direction. And it is, from the physical point of view, characterized by a scattering vector. And the scattering vector is normal to these Bragg ratings. Yeah, the Bragg ratings. This is Fourier space, and this is direct space. I'm not sure how far you are familiar with Fourier theory. One of the medical students once asked me, now, what is that? Do we live in direct space, or do we live in Fourier space, or what else? So, anyway, the Fourier space but gives us, or raises an important question. You see, what can we do if we use OCT? We can use different wavelengths. Scattered light then is on this Ewald sphere. Shorter wavelengths, scattering vectors are located on this Ewald sphere, then we have this of numerical aperture. That means we have access to these Fourier points here within the green margin here. But the general sample must have a Fourier spectrum like this red light distribution here. That means from the reality, we only obtain an extremely small section using OCT. This is also the same with other optical imaging techniques. The question is, can we afford to miss all this information or not? Well, of course, at the moment, we have no chance to get all this information. But we also can get this information, what is green here, but not what is really possible. We do not see the reality. That is the the point or the conclusion from that. So that is, the red cloud is the Fourier data distribution of a general sample. Green is available, and then somewhere is blue. I might have missed that here. Also, blue would mean, I have to explain that point here, should be number three, would be only data on a surface here, if we only use one wavelength. We do not even have a three-dimensional Fourier domain where we can get the data. And the result of that is speckle. Dennis Garber, by the way, has pointed to that fact, that the reason for speckle is this problem here. Now, this consideration leads to some question that I already mentioned. How unique can such a small Fourier data set be, for example? Do we see the reality? Is there a typical Fourier domain structure for a typical sample, for example, healthy skin or so? Does such a skin have a typical Fourier spectrum? Or are relevant sample properties located at the characteristic K-space regions? We do not know that. Maybe it's a question for the future. So, finally, we could say, or I could say here, if we want to increase this volume here, we need to decrease the coherence length. Larger wavelength interval means shorter coherence length. If we want to increase this range in the transverse direction, we have to increase the numerical aperture. Or plus, we use multidirectional illumination. It's always useful to stand or to change the point of view also in normal life. Okay. So, that brings me, how much time do I have? That brings me, I might have to speed up. Well, what we need in Fourier domain technology are tuning light sources. Such tuning light sources, typical tuning light sources, are ring lasers. And there's a real avenue of developments at the moment. So this is a standard ring laser. So it's a fiber. And such a fiber can have, no, the standard ring laser is here. Such a fiber can have two waves propagating in two different directions. One has to introduce here something like a rectifier or a so-called isolator to select out one wave in the resonator. This is the first step. Next step is to generate or to develop so-called Fourier domain locked lasers. They can deliver still higher frequencies of swept frequency light, and then one can use buffered Fourier domain lasers. They can deliver extremely sequences of swept frequency signals. For example, using such a system, it has been possible, it's already some time ago, in 2006, OCT images with 1 gigavoxel per second, 1 to the 10 hoch high 12, no, 9, voxels, 1,000 million voxels per second. So that is extremely fast. Okay. So, I do not know all these things, but I'll show you some movies, so that is more. This can only be done in the computer here. What do I show you here? We shall see an OCT from a spiral water from a resistive spiral in water that was heated electrically, giving rise to convection. So it is a rather artificial example, but it is the first. Has been performed 1 year ago. And the technology that has been used here is swept source Fourier domain, buffered Fourier domain laser with four-dimensional OCT using or delivering 26 gigavoxels per second. So that is a huge information volume delivered per second. And what one really can see is that it works in three dimensions. And we see a drop of milk. You see the heating spiral here, this view from upside. Then we can look from the side to the spiral, the penetration depth is not large enough that we would see the whole spiral, but we see the upper half of the spiral. Yeah. Then a milk drop will coming from above, should at least. Yeah. Maybe I have to start it once again. Yeah. So it's a movie with 26 voxels, with 26 volumes per second. Yeah, a whole volume just as a movie obtained with OCT technology. Then you might have the feeling, oh, what is that nonsense? I have really a problem to make that clear for you, I understand. Okay. I'm sure you are much more convinced, and most of you will know that if you see that movie. And maybe for those people who do not yet know, it's 10 years old or more, has been produced in Vienna. That looks very convincing, huh? But the information content compared to the movie before is three or four orders of magnitude different, yeah, lower. So the question I showed you, the two pictures, is the question is, what will be the future? Does this high progress or the super high speed Fourier domain give progress? For example, it would be possible, and that is, of course, not yet shown, it would be possible to have a synopsis of three-dimensional, real-time, polychromatic, polarization-sensitive, Doppler, all these in one OCT image, yeah? Three-dimensional. So that would be an extremely new type of diagnostics for the clinic, of course. I feel that is the future. Okay. So, I will not discuss this. I only explain what is meant. ESAM forms a coherent aperture. I feel it's equivalent to an array anyway. Publication activity of that group has severely ceased in the last 1 or 2 years. So the first result seemed very convincing. Okay. Then we have another advanced technology, master slave interferometry, put forward by Professor Podoliano at Kent University. But since this is in England, this is endoscopy, and I feel most interesting this technology, OMAC, and DOMAC. And that has been formed at Oregon University. And what they show is blood flow in the brain, yeah? So they show that if you have anastomosis, then if you block one part of the arterial blood supply, will be replaced via the anastomosis from another arterial system. Okay, that is a very beautiful work. I'm very sorry that I'm so slow in my talk. Okay. And maybe finally, yes, is there what the Swiss people call diabetes imaging, FOCI? Here I am. Functional optical coherence tomography. It combines spectrometer-based Fourier domain OCT plus an exocon lens here with segmentation. Segmentation procedure is indicated here. Results are shown here, and you know that picture. Thank you very much.
Please steer the microphone.
The computer. Ladies and gentlemen, this presentation actually is an evidence of what kind of standard is expected to win this award. And of course, this could be used as a benchmark. Professor Fercher kindly agreed to answer a few questions. And I will take questions in turn if you show me your hand. Please stay with me. Professor Reagan.
Professor, 3 years ago, I was in Copenhagen at an international conference for skin imaging. The most exciting thing in that program was several dermatologists claiming that they had completely stopped needle biopsies of things like malignant melanoma suspect by being able to carry out on the spot in the clinic OCT examination, which produced on the screen an image which was as informative as a microscopic section. Now, I wondered if you could just comment on the potential future for that and what sort of probable depth penetration you may be getting.
Yeah. Depth penetration is the critical figure, of course. Skin penetration is in the order of magnitude of 1 millimeter. So it would only see the surface of a melanoma. In addition, melanoma are black, so that by absorption, penetration depth is additionally reduced. So one has to use measures to increase the penetration depths in the skin. You could simply use water, for example. Wet skin has a larger penetration depth than dry skin. You have to reduce scattering. Scattering is the most important process that reduces penetration depth in skin. Scattering depends on the refractive index differences. So dry skin has a much smaller penetration depth than wet skin. And then you can use special oils, which additionally reduces or increases the depth penetration.
In ophthalmology, OCT imaging is changing very rapidly. We now have the Strepsils OCT, followed by Angio, OptiView OCT. What's coming next, sir?
Well, there's an old joke. The questions for the future are most difficult questions, in particular if they concern the future. It's very difficult. I would say Strepsils OCT, of course, will be still faster using these Fourier domain mode-locked lasers. That is what I expect. The intensity question, yes. I'm not sure if that will be a limit, yes. But the sensitivity is extremely high at the moment. Is that really a severe problem, the intensity? Is that your experience, yes?
Uh-huh. I don't have much experience in that, you know, but the problem is high intensity lasers could cause damage, couldn't they?
Oh, yes, of course. No, there's no chance with high intensities, no. Uh-huh. Yes, that will remain a limit, I am afraid, yes, of course.
Have you any experience with that, sir?
No, I have no personal experience in ophthalmology, no.
Thank you for answering his question. I thought you were going to say, if I had a crystal ball, I'll tell you. Yes, please.
Do you see a problem? You have a technique or techniques that are developed by physicists, and you have sent them to clinicians or medics, if you like, to use. Do you see a problem there between what the expectation of the user and the actual limitations of the technique? Do the clinicians understand the limitations of the technique?
So the question is more or less who pushes progress more? Do it the clinicians or do it the physicists? I think together.
I hear it, yes.
That is the important point. That is my personal experience. As I explained at the beginning, I asked the people, what can I do for you? I was pressed to do something because I had to educate medical students. Why did I leave Carl Zeiss company? They came in financial problems because of their cooperation with Yashica.
Once the technique is commercialized, the manufacturers have an interest in selling as many possible. Are they going to overestimate or overemphasize the advantage of a technique and not mention the limitations? I always see this problem. Well, once the technique is commercialized, the aim is to sell and not necessarily to be too truthful about the limitations. Do you see that as a problem?
I can give another example. Maybe that helps a little. when we saw that we could perform eye length measurement, very precise. And the advantages are clear. Higher precision means better results in refractive surgery. No contact with the eye would not transfer cornea infection and so on. And when we contacted the Zeiss company, we contacted an Austrian company that had just started the program in laser medicine. They were not keen enough to go into the ophthalmologic field. So we contacted then the Carl Zeiss company because I had old contacts, of course. And they also did not do that. So the details are, in 1982, I applied for a patent for the eye length measurement, and the Carl Zeiss company built the first instrument in 2000. There were still 2 years within the 20 years of a patent. In the first 2 years, most of the money goes into market cooperation or introduction to the market. So the money, I'm not sure if you're interested in that, I earned from that was sufficient to buy a notebook for my daughter, that was it. So what was the problem they told me? They said to me, no, we don't need that. We have the ultrasound. It's a too high risk. So the higher quality was not convincing them. And then when they did it in 2000, what did they say to me? They told me, oh yes, now we have found out that if we introduce the optical system to the clinics and to the doctors, then the Fortzimmer Dame, the assistant lady in the reception, can do it. And we do not need educated doctors for doing that. And that was the reason why they introduced that instrument into the market.
Well, do I have another question? I'm mindful of the time because I know you people came straight from work and you want to go back to your families. Any comments, any questions? Yes.
As a simple clinician, thank God we have people like you. You know, because if it was left to the physics and the technology, I'd say we'd still be in the dark ages. So having listened to your lecture there, I can't really understand most of it, but like, you know, clinically, OCT in ophthalmology has transformed the speciality, you know? So thank you.
Right. It was fascinating to hear about some of the modern OCT techniques that are directly related to Fourier domain OCT together with the particular applications. He showed us very simple diagrams and calculations, which no doubt we all understood. Professor Fercher, right. May I thank you on behalf of the Royal Photographic Society, on behalf of the Royal College of Physicians, on behalf of the Royal College Combined Committee meeting, which includes me, and on behalf of every representative, and indeed on my own behalf. Your presentation was excellent, informative, and thought-provoking. And I thank you for finding time to be with us. I wish you well. I wish you a safe journey home. Although a bit early, on behalf of everybody, I wish you Merry Christmas. Before we close the meeting, I would like to thank our host, Royal College of Physicians, who has supported the society and for their partnership in running this award and make it a success every year. Professor Luxton, would you be kind enough to convey our regard to the college?
Thank you.
I would also like to thank our very busy, newly elected President Walter Benzie to find time to be with us because he runs a very busy schedule now. And of course, he runs a very busy accounting practice as well. I must also thank the Director General, Michael Pritchard, who provided an important ingredient in the form of wine to get the evening started. Least but not last, I would like to thank Joe McDonald, who does a lot of logistics in organizing the main awards night, and indeed this Royal College Combined Medal as well. Now, very briefly, the award was established in 1958 in collaboration with the Royal College of Physicians of London, the Royal College of Surgeons of England, and Royal College of Obstetric and Gynecology. The Combined Royal College Medal is awarded for an outstanding contribution to the advancement and or application of medical photography for the wider field of medical imaging. The very first recipient was in 1958, Charles Engel, who was the head of medical photography at Guy's Hospital in London. So you can see how far back it goes.
Remember Keith who got it?
Yes, eventually many got it, but the first person to receive was Charles Engel. So on that note, having thanked everybody, may I wish you safe journey home. Thank you very much.
Thank you.